reminder to please switch off your cell phones and enjoy the evening. Looking forward to your questions and discussions after the presentations. Thank you. Mesdames et Messieurs, Professor Terry Reed.
At UB Media Study for 9 years now, and it's really a delight to see the program and the faculty growing in new directions with the addition of new faculty, Sana Waham included, and Margaret Reed, who you both know from this class. So it's an extraordinary pleasure and honor for me to introduce and welcome Xiaoxin Wei tonight. I've known him since 2001, or at least I've known of his work since then, as I had a former student and colleague who worked under his direction at the master's and doctoral level. And so I learned about his research kind of through a third party for many years, and yet eventually met him in 2004. And his thinking has infused my own, whether he knows it or not. My doctoral work was a bibliography much influenced by your research, by your practice, and by your influence on many advisees who have called you mentor over the years. He's an extraordinary mentor. Xin Wei is also a pivotal figure in what I think of as a group that has been carving out a common plane of inquiry across art and philosophy, science and engineering, including names that you may know, Brian Misumi and Aaron Manning, whom he worked with directly in his years at Concordia, Karen Barad, Isabel Stengers, Francois Laruelle. These are the names of many internationally renowned figures thinking across domains of art and philosophy, thinking of them together as a doing. And I think you'll see that tonight and begin to appreciate what that might mean through this talk. I'm going to tell you a bit about his background because I think it's very important for you to recognize what a unique figure it takes to be able to operate at this intersection and to create programs like our own, which is seeking to prepare a next generation of thinkers who can carve out spaces like this through advanced study. Xiaoxin Wei is a professor and director of the School of Arts, Media, and Engineering in the Herberger Institute for Design and the Arts and Fulton Schools of Engineering at Arizona State University. He's also director of the Synthesis Center for Transversal Art, Philosophy, and Technology at Arizona State University, and is also a fellow of the ASU Santa Fe Institute Center for Biosocial Complex Systems. He also serves as faculty at the European Graduate School. He's formed labs at all of these institutions across his career, including the Topological Media Lab at Georgia Tech, Tea Garden, and Sponge, which predated that. He was on the West Coast. And the works coming out of these labs have been recognized by some of the most prestigious venues in the world, in across arts, science, and technology, including Arts Electronica, the Dutch Electronic Art Festival, Mediaterra Athens, SIGGRAPH, DEF, BAMP Center for the Arts, and many others. His work has also been recognized by awards from major cultural foundations, including the Daniel Langlois Foundation for Art, Science, and Technology, the LEFF Foundation, the Creative Work Fund in New York, and the Rockefeller Foundation. His most recent monograph is entitled Poesis and Enchantment in Topological Matter. It's MIT Press 2013. And he's also published widely in academic journals, peer-reviewed publications, including those associated with Ubicomp, ICMC, Sound and Music Computing, rather, and ACM Multimedia. He was trained in mathematics at Harvard and Stanford universities and worked more than 12 years in the fields of scientific computation, mathematical modeling, and the visualization of scientific data and geometric structures. In 1995, he extended his work to network media authoring systems and media theory, coordinating a 3-year-long workshop on interaction and computational media at Stanford. In 1997, he co-founded Pliant Research with colleagues from Xerox PARC and Apple Research Labs, dedicated to designing technologies that people and organizations can trust and reshape to meet evolving needs. evolving socioeconomic needs. In 1999, Shaw joined Interval Research to work on machine learning and computer vision. This was a very pivotal moment, a very experimental lab founded by Paul Allen, one of the co-founders of Apple. And after obtaining an interdisciplinary PhD in 2001 at Stanford on differential geometric performance and the technologies of writing in mathematics, computer science, and history and philosophy of science, Shaw joined the faculty at the School of Literature, Communication, and Culture at the Georgia Institute of Technology. He also was part of the research faculty in the Graphics Visualization and Usability Center in the College of Computing there, where he founded the Topological Media Lab, dedicated to the study of gesture, distributed agency, and materiality, with application to the phenomenology of performance in the built environment. In 2005 through 2014, he was the first Canada Research Chair in Media Arts and Sciences and Associate Professor of Fine Arts at Concordia University in Montreal. He was the Access Director for Wearable and Active Textiles at Hexagram Center for Research Creation in Media Arts and Technologies there. And he taught in Design and Computation Arts Department, as well as the Graduate Individualized Program and the Humanities Special Program at Concordia University, where they deliver practice-based PhDs at the intersection of practice and theory. Shaw Shinway's work with the Topological Media Lab has been supported by the Canada Fund for Innovation, Hexagram, Concordia University, Social Sciences Humanities Research Council, and many other organizations. And he's been, again, as I said, a very pivotal figure in shaping the discourse around media arts, media philosophy, and the intersection of making and doing. And I think you'll understand better what that means as I give the floor to him. Please join me in welcoming Shaw Shinway.
So that's good. It gives me a sense of who. The reason I ask is because the techniques that we've used, been using for all these years come from these good kinds of areas, but also coming from engineering and computer science and also from philosophy and literature. Okay, so that's what's called Synthesis Center now. Basically, I'd like to show you tonight a lot of different kinds of work. I want to first say it's not my work, really. It's about 150 very courageous people. People who kind of like maybe were misfits in their home domains, but really good at it, and they want to do something more with their talent and their abilities. So I credit these people over about 15 years, in addition to many, many students. So that's really what we're going to look at tonight. First, I want to look at work by some major artists that you may have seen. So this is it. Does anybody recognize where this is, first of all? Without looking at the fine print. It's not around here. It's in the Grand Palace, the Grand Palais in Paris. It's a photograph, so these are not, it's not computer model. This is a work by Anush Kapoor. When you enter this gigantic hall, you see this object, I have no idea what it is, and you can go inside. This is what you see inside. Inside, it's a completely different world. Already from the outside, you see this giant balloon-like thing or a whale that's occupying most of the space, and then it's already changing in how you think of that crystal palace. And you go inside, you see another transformed world, and the sound's different. It's a very thick skin made of some sort of vinyl plastic. It's an amazing space. So this is an artist who's transformed how we can view the world around us. This is another one, Chiharu Shigota. I think a marvelous Japanese installation artist who did these kinds of pieces. Again, this is a real piano, a room full of chairs. And she strung, or she and her assistants, I guess, strung thousands of threads, streaming the space with these kinds of, I don't know what, like implied music. So again, this is a poetic transformation of the environment. I think I have one more. So here's, that doesn't have to be as elaborate or as official as those kinds of transformations of space. There's also this piece. It's a work by some artists, architects. I think this was in Spain. Anyway, it appeared in a catalog of Basque work, or work in Basque. And sorry about that. So these kinds of ways of thinking about how these kinds of conditionings of the environment, we can think of them as the work and that's it, or you can think about how they change your perspective, right? So I know I was talking to certain people coming from film in my school, and we say films tell stories. And I say, well, we also have other areas too, like in architecture, or design, or sculpture. Some can be said to tell stories, but other times they just not so much telling a story, but changing your experience. So a lot of what I'm going to be talking about tonight has to do with how we make things that change your experience of the world. So that's basically it. Using all sorts of techniques. So synthesis, well, you'll see why do synthesis. But one of the ways I kind of motivate a lot of the work, because the work that we do, just a reminder to remind you, is coming from not just arts and design and film and performing arts, but also draws a lot from signal processing, from mathematics, from philosophy, science and technology studies, anthropology, critical studies, and also many other fields of engineering. The question is, for what purpose, what for? So we say different kinds of, we have different motivations that we call, align. One of them is practical. So this is a photograph of, I don't know what, a large, probably a refinery, could be a refinery. So, if you look at, people make amazing things. Just a gigantically complex systems. Let's say a power plant or oil refinery or your ATM banking system, let's say. And we can say, well, what does all this technology do for us? Well, if you had smaller class, had more time, it would be more Q&A and talking, okay? But I'm going to barrel through every time at the end for more conversation, okay? But please write down your questions and we can have a conversation after I show you some stuff, okay? So I show pictures to people of ATM machines or this kind of thing, say, or your cell phone network, and say, well, we have all these technologies, but they seem to make our lives more complicated. So all the devices that we make, my background also includes different kinds of experimental software, they might answer one task, but they also increase our cognitive load and make life more complicated. At the same time as they try to enable everyday tasks, right? Think of the Uber car that just killed a woman in my town back in ASU, Tempe, Arizona. Being tested for self-driving. So how do we actually justify this kind of what I'm trying to do, just before I leave the slide, is we deal typically with complexity by divide and conquer. So the object is to make the city, help people get to work on time. So you deal with the asphalt on the streets, you deal with electricity, you deal with the refineries, you deal with the oil system, gasoline distribution network, etc. We divide and conquer the issue of transportation, right? But think about it, if these parts, these people, these expertise don't talk to one another, we wind up with these Rube Goldberg contraptions, systems. Right? Same thing happens in medicine. So scientific method is this idea was, we can say this idea of divide and conquer. I'm a cosmologist, you're you're a photographer, so we do our job and hopefully we make one world together. But this kind of modern analytic approach has been tended to make more and more complex technologies and more fractured modes of knowledge production. This is common. I mean, many people say this. We all say this, right? So I wanted to do something about it and just point a finger. So how do we think about synthesizing practices and synthesizing modes of knowledge, where the mode of knowledge is a new kind of science? What I mean by that is making knowledge, not just, say, chemistry or photography, but a new mode of making knowledge where what you learn or insights that you gather, we can share with other people, and they take into account both matters of fact and matters of, like how many gallons per mile is this car chewing up, and matters of value. So this is a good thing. Do we want it? Why do we want this? So all in one kind of work, right? So the kind of work that we've been doing, you can say, I'll show you more, this is just a barrage. They span different kind of areas. So in the top areas, it may look to some people, some of the work looks like immersive environments for understanding scientific models of the weather, or it could look like a bit of ways to understand new kinds of lighting control, which is more like technology side versus science technology work. Or it could be a dance performance where we're working with dancers are trying to understand how to move inspired by the way that plants move, vegetal life. Or another one, which is an installation in a museum in Paris. So it just look like very different kinds of things depending on the context. But it's the same group of people with same kits of techniques. Okay? So, divide and conquer. So, I said that was like the beginning of modern science. That's a modern way to understand the world, right? So, first person, one of the first scientists we say for today is Isaac Newton. And anybody remember the story for this? This is one of the story related to Isaac Newton. So besides gravity, he also was credited with the first modern theory of optics. And remember the famous experiment, Isaac Newton took a piece of triangular prism of glass and ran white light into it, and out came a rainbow of colors. So he showed by experiment with an instrument that white light is actually made up of colors. First one to demonstrate that according to the history of physics. What we're doing with synthesis, I say, is the opposite. Is we take all these different ways of understanding the world, the physicists, let's say, and we run it through our synthesis group of people and apparatus and techniques, and we produce tinted light, not pure light, depends on your mixture. So that's the analogy. It takes a long time to get that, get it together. And to do what? Well, we make experiments. It is like science, and that's experimental. I'm gonna show you a whole bunch of experiments now, but think of them as experiments. And what we mean by that, first of all, is that it's about experience. Experiments with experience. So the thing is that we could, it's about, at the end of the day, we're trying to think of ways to make life richer or less complicated with environments that are less complicated but more enlivening or enriching. We can say that's a big goal. But how do we learn to do that? Well, we do it bit by bit with experiments. And experiments can be very small, like putting a contact mic here and see what happens to my voice. Okay. But it's always about whole experiments. And that's what's a bit different than maybe standard laboratory bench level science, where we focus on just one percent, very little stimulus, maybe the sound in the ear or a dot of light. But instead we're thinking more like theater, in theatrical model where we take the entire thick experience of life. It could be having a dinner, or it could be waiting for the bus, and then make that magic, enchant that event, so that everyday actions could acquire great symbolic charge. So a lot of the work we've been doing for 50 years is to use all the techniques, from theater, from lighting, from electronics, from dance, whatever, to be able to augment our environment such that ordinary activities acquire poetic charge. Okay, that's kind of a one-line way to think about what we've been doing for all these years. Excuse me, but it doesn't have to involve a lot of technology. Sound processing, okay? But we were trying to use this kind of these rules of thumb called minimax, meaning maximum experiential condition for or impact for the minimum technology, minimum. So that meant we had all sorts of technologies available to us that we created using responsive media systems. And said, but first, no electricity. That's the first thing. Try to do it without electricity. And then I said, okay, if you still can't achieve it, I'll give you electricity. If you still can't achieve what you want to do, something more you want to do, I'll give you a computer, and moreover, I'll give you access to WB professionals who can construct new types of hardware you cannot buy off any shelf, and new algorithms that mathematicians will construct for you, for our purpose. Okay, so we have deep virtuosic techniques in different areas. Which is why it took 150 people over all these different years, right, from different areas working together. Okay, this is a simple case, but it can be much more ambitious. It's like this. So what you're seeing is a work in Montreal where we put 13 tons of sand into a black box. I should have done the survey before. I don't know if anybody here has worked with much with Max and Speed Jitter. If you can raise your hand in the dark, I might try to see you. Not much. So this is a system used for real-time media processing that is kind of our lingua franca for the laboratory. So in this case, we have a camera looking down at the whole scene, and we put 13 tons of sand, so people, when you walk on this floor, you feel sand under your feet. It's no longer a black box. So the environment is already transformed. And then when people walk around freely, you can do whatever you want. You can throw a ball, roll on the sand. We held classes in this, dance classes in this situation. We even had a faculty meeting with the dean in the second, business meeting, for example. We had people doing puppet theater in this setting. So it's completely transformed as a setting. But we tried to do everyday activities in that setting. And then people could just play. We'd throw the sand in the air. And when you throw the sand in the air, what happens is that we have optical flow tracking. We have computer vision, simple computer vision, which takes any movement, not a body, but any movement, and takes the vectors of movement across the camera field and use it as a virtual wind to blow across a virtual particle system, which then in turn we interpret as light. And that, in other words, it's used to convert to video or to control signals we send to a theatrical system, which is projected back onto the floor. And then people respond to that. So this is a set of poetic transformations, you know, from physical movement to computer vision to light and sound, fields of sound, which is sonified all in real time, and back to bodies again. So this is an example of a very elaborate way of enchanting the space in response to activity. And remember I was saying earlier, uh, this is a life-size screen that we put in the middle of the space in my current lab called the Synthesis Center. And soon we'll be able to We're working with the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, Colorado, where we took their standard CM1 model, which is for modeling atmosphere, the weather, like pressure, humidity, water content, snow, ice, temperature, and wind velocity. And in this case, we show you, here's a life-size picture of our bodies, if you face the scrim. And as you move about, you yourself are turned into air, a mass of warm, moist air. And your air, the body that's you, your body becomes a mass of air and rises because it's hot. And as it rises, the physics will make the air condense into clouds. The sound that you're hearing, unfortunately this is probably stereo sound, is actually sonified in 8 bands, which are mapped to a ring of 8 Meyer speakers. Very, very rich and precise sonic spatialization of the audio, so that you can hear yourself moving around and around the space as you walk from right to left. Okay. So we have very precise and rich control or synthesis of the sonic environment. So it comes, but it comes through the clouds. It doesn't come from your body directly. It comes from the massing of clouds overhead. All right. So that's an example of how we can make a very rich environment where it's not about looking at somebody else's picture of a scene. You are the scene. You are the matter. You are the flow of activity itself. Okay. So a lot of the work that we're doing in synthesis is not so much about making a representation of something else, but we are transforming your environment in which you're sitting or standing and augmenting that. Okay.
What do you learn?
This is a lot smaller. This is about, you know, like the size of this podium. This is very recent, like four weeks ago. We invited some friends from the Topological Media Lab in Montreal, my former lab, to come to Phoenix and did a residency. And it's also about atmosphere. But whereas before, we're talking with people from the national, from NCARS, the scientists doing atmosphere science and turning that into a poetic space. Here, we're looking at actual an array of transducers to make a mist, to actually control the mist from XMSP, driving it either by sound or by video, by in this case by gesture, physical gesture, so that we can actually, you can make your own cloud. We could have a box which is your own cloud. You know how, you know, when you go climbing up a mountain, you see the cloud overhead, clouds overhead, but as you walk into the mountain, into the cloud, then it becomes fog. There's no point at which really that you have this, well, very rarely, except in California, I guess, you have actually a cloud that you can reach out and just grab onto, right? You know this feeling? It's always been like frustrating to me, like clouds look amazing from a distance, but when you walk closer and closer, it just goes into a general fog. Here, we made a little baby fog, like a little cloud nursery. Just reach your hands in, stir it up, and blow on it. But you can also modulate the cloud using our MaxMSP array of transducers, little atomizers. There's no heat, it's just mechanical. And then we could think about how gestures shape the clouds. And listen. First of all, it's beautiful, but what's the research question behind this? Well, also, I'm always asking why. Why? One of the reasons for this kind of work, a couple, is for about 20 years, we've been looking at this question of what is language? What's writing? What's writing? When you take your hand and dip into, take your brush and dip into ink and draw it across a piece of paper, that's making a stroke for a painting or writing. And we're very interested in the nuance that you can get by drawing a hand across, or brush across paper, and nuance it infinitely, far more richly than we can do with a keyboard. So, but then we say, well, that's already kind of framed by pencil on paper or brush on silk. So instead, we think, what is the medium itself? That is the distinction between what's the substrate and what's the ink. We can experiment with that. So we've been building these kinds of systems where we can actually experiment with varying the relationship between substrate and mark, for example. So that's an example of fundamental research in this domain between what's language, what's representation, what's a mark, what's substrate. Okay. The other reason for doing this is we've been thinking about, well, you know, we've talked about like what is a body. We're trying to make it environments where the distinction between like body and world is ambiguous. So you can play with that as well. Coming back to bodies. This is, we've also been working with dancers because we're thinking about interaction, well, bodies interacting with systems. We're thinking, well, why don't we talk to people who are very expert at this kind of corporeal practice, dancers and musicians, performing musicians. So in this case, we're working with dancers who can improvise in front of our reactive systems, responsive systems, and invent new gestures on the spot. So any gesture you do makes a nuanced sound. It's the way that you know you can modulate your voice, right? Whereas if you and live, right, on the spot, you can invent a different kind of orientation of your voice. Whereas if you record your voice, you play it back, and it's all you can do. Play it back the same way every single time. So a lot of our work has been making responsive media so that you can nuance it on the fly in real time, as richly as you can modulate your voice. In this case, with your body, you know, if we give you this kind of system, Well, if I move my hand in certain ways, you may not know how to do that, right? So we're building systems where you don't have to read a user manual. You don't have just five gestures like cut, copy, paste, or pinch, or swipe. That's too primitive, right? It's about giving you and your body infinite degrees of freedom that's as rich as waving your hand through mist, but in this case, through real-time synthesized sound and video, that you can nuance the way you nuance your voice. So she's an expert, so she knows how to modulate your body on the spot. So we're learning from people like her who can instantly learn to couple her body to the responsive media. You can see when she smiles, and I'll let it again. We asked her to do this, and we're not even telling her what part we're responding to. There's no one part, but we're trying to look for fine features. We're looking at the way the face is moving, the way her fingers and limbs are moving. And you'll see at some point when she drops her hands and wriggles or drops her foot, she's coupled to the system, and she smiles because she feels like she's coupled to the system. We look for smiles, okay. And now you can hear it again, and then you can, actually the mismatch between the audio and video is worse, much worse than it was in real life because of an editing problem. So I'll play it again. Something amazing. Dancers, I don't know if some of these here coming from dance, had an amazing sense of proprioception and a sense of where your body is in respect to space. So she hit that mark without even looking at it. She walked backward right on the mark. So this is also something we're studying. And here we're working with people from neuroscience now, who are looking at this kind of a sense, but the way they do it is to put a sensor on the body and have bolt the person to a table and move one part of the body at a time. That's completely unrealistic. So we're trying to bring into the neuroscience a lot richer example of how to understand how people move. So let me skip a bunch of stuff. Now, again, remember we're talking about rich gestural interfaces. In this case, it's not about one person. We're very interested in collective movement, how groups of people work together. Because the PC, the personal computer, was designed for one person working with one computer. And in your pockets, you have a small PC that is a phone, a smartphone, which, you know, is a computer designed for one person shrunk down to a pocket, which is actually pretty silly because a big computer has certain kind of affordances for the body. You know, the screen is so big, the mouse is so big, because the body is so big. So here we're talking about a large object which is sensitive to collective gesture by two or three or four, as many people as you can fit. And I'll describe what's going on, but let you hear it. Tapestry woven on the computer loom called the Jacquard loom. Anybody know the Jacquard loom? Yes, it's a mechanical weaving device. So it's just the beginning of computers, actually, from the 19th century, because they used punch cards to model these things, to control these things. But this is a computer-controlled Jacquard loom. It's a one-of-a-kind. It's woven with cotton and silver or thread. The silver thread is conductive. So all the birds and patterns you see, the darker patterns, those are conductive thread. So they're actually a sensor. The sensor, the pattern is the sensor. And there are 12 birds, about 12 birds in that pattern. And the darker lines conduct data, or rather electrical potential, from those birds to microprocessors. So what we did is we collaborated with a weaving laboratory making conductive active textiles, Joey Brzozka in Concordia, and with Computer Music Technology Center in McGill University, and we had our own composers. So we made a kind of instrument that you can play collectively just by moving your hand. So for example, if you push your hand about 6 inches, if you hover your hand about 6 inches over the cloth, you begin to hear a wind sound. And then you can modulate that by waving and wiggling your fingers, and then you come closer to within an inch or so. It changes into something else. It could change into like laughter, like a voice. And then when you finally touch it, it can turn into fire or fish or something. So we can modulate by making surprising mappings between the gesture and the sound that you hear. So it's not like just scratching. And this is instrument because we have other composers who came in and did very different kinds of mappings to this instrument. Talking about one of the streams of research we're doing has to do with rhythm, understanding rhythm. So here the question is something like, so there, again, there are always these questions about what are we trying to learn from these kinds of experiential experiments. Here's this whole series of work about rhythm. You can ask, you know, what's rhythm? It can be like this, kind of like, and then it can be, right? So you can have this different kind of rhythm, musical rhythms, let's say, that are put together in some regular pattern. But it doesn't have to be one-dimensional rhythm. So all the tools that we have, like Final Cut or Adobe Premiere, or you know, certain kinds of sound editing tools like Logic, they're based on a time track, right? We're all familiar with that, most of us, right? But that assumes that time is one-dimensional. Here, we're looking at a situation where it's not about just one-dimensional types of temporality. And what you're hearing right now is the breakdown of correlation between three bodies, we asked them to, that's what, to pretend right now that you're, they're a clock. And they're a clock, like, this is what we said. You're a clock, the three of you, and you're the mechanism of a clock. And the way you should move is try to move such that there's a space, counter space, always filled by body. And that's all we need to say. To an expert mover, they know what to do. Do not say, put your hand here, put your hand there. They play with that instruction, that condition, that movement, and they do this. Okay. So this is what's the joy of working with professional dancers or near professional dancers, that you give them these kinds of constraints on movement, and they invent on the spot a fresh way of moving that satisfies those constraints. Then, there were some of them about wearing microprocessors that we built for detecting orientation, so that it's not about, the question is, when are they working together and when are they not together? When are people coordinated when they're not coordinated? The sound composer, the synthesis composer, wrote his music synthesis system such that it became more and more noisy when the bodies were less correlated. So in this case, what is the correlation? It's about orientation. So you can ask this. If you're in the living or in the kitchen, and then maybe one person's washing dishes, another person's is frying up the next dish, food, and somebody is on the phone, when are people in the scene together? And when are they not together, correlated in some way? But in a way that's just not, it's not, because they might be moving in completely incommensurate ways. Right? The gestures of the body are really quite different. So the way we're thinking about that is, well, maybe the beginning to that would be to think about which way are the parts of the body oriented. No. If I go like this, everybody in the room, or make a bang, will turn their heads toward the bang, right? So the orientation happens to be coordinated in time and by angle, not by where you are. So that's the beginning of the work. And I'll end with this set of work that spans everything. It goes from thinking about things more philosophically to working with dance to making installation work. And it has to do with vegetal life. It's called the Seral Project with Juan Ashutelo Pintilian, a filmmaker from Romania and Paris, worked for 25 years in film, doing different kinds of documentary film and film with animation with the National Film Board. About 7 or 8 years ago, in our new building in Montreal, I talked to the architect. I talked to the architect, and he said that we'll never be able to grow plants in our building because the building is too dry. So I said, well, we're a media lab, we can do anything. So we decided to try to grow different ways of growing plants and systems that were kind of semi-automatic. So then we started reading about plant and plant life, about thinking, what does it make? What does it mean to be a plant? To what is it? Because first of all, okay, well, plants don't move. But then if you work with time mass, obviously plants move. They have social behavior, they have, maybe we could say it's social, but they certainly have some sort of coordinated movement, ensemble movement, and they may have some sort of intentionality. So we read philosophers, we read Goethe, we read Darwin, we read Michael Marder, we read Aristotle. We did a whole series of seminars in philosophy, which then inspired some work with Jeanette Arendt, who's one of the most inventive choreographers in Canada. Working with dancers who are trying to inspire new kinds of movement inspired by this kind of vegetal being, vegetal movement. So this is from a few years ago, and currently what we're doing, I think you'll see in a minute, is we're building environments where it's not just for professional dancers, it's environments where anybody walk into that space, your time, your sense of time will be changed. So it would seem as if your time in that space is the time of plants. That is, you can perceive the world around you the way the plant might perceive, may perceive the world around you. Okay? Of course, it's impossible to really do with your body, I mean, that's not what we are, we're not plants. But it's a way to think about what would it be like to suggest what the world might be like if you had the point of view of plants.
Okay. So it gives you a sense. And this is what you saw earlier and went up to the preamble.
So basically the point is this. We're trying to take all these things that people take for given, you know, for granted. Body, plants, matter, a gesture, what's a gesture, even what's a number, you know, and say, well, maybe we shouldn't just be so quick to assume we know what they are. So if we say experiment, we really even experiment with the concept. So where does the body end? Where does my body end, and where does the world begin? Mm-hmm. Or is a gesture only that which goes from cadence to cadence? And we turn those kinds of assumptions, which are standard in engineering, let's say, or science, into questions. So maybe the body, my body doesn't end with my skin or my clothing. In some sense, my corporeal existence, gearing into the world, to use Merleau-Ponty, the way I gear into the world is actually variable. It depends on where my attention is. If I look at the door, I look at the exit sign, I'm already there. An actor knows that, a philosopher knows that. So maybe the computer vision techniques should not assume that my body ends at my skin.
So, let's see if we can pause this one thing.
I'll leave you something flat, because we actually have a lot of fun doing this kind of service work. I'll leave you with this last example of how we're making custom instruments for doing the archives of experiments. The sound you're hearing is not amplification. It's not the sound of the actual object. It's all synthesized with hundreds of processes that are parameterized by features extracted from the stream of data coming from the microphone. This is my favorite. Of research going on right now. I wasn't trying to be too systematic about that. Underneath, technically, in terms of the art and engineering, we're doing work with responsive environments, any kind of environment. That is any kind of lighting system, video, sound system, surround, specialized sound, anything can do with sensors, anything can do with robotics. That's what we work with. But we're working with new ways of understanding movement inside the environment and in real time, changing the system, okay, changing your environment. So we're beginning to work outdoors as well as indoors, et cetera. Okay, so that's kind of the kind of meat and potatoes underneath all this stuff. In terms of the research, there are like, you know, four or five, and they're all about questions that are good for maybe two or three or four or five years, meaning people can hold, pursue them for that amount of time. And like I said, one of them is algorithm. And for that, we're looking at the question is, what's rhythm, basically? That's a research question. What is rhythm? And, you know, but if you ask a media artist, like, it's a scale of milliseconds, like, and a maximum speed scale of 1 millisecond, right? Audio is more, it's less. And if you ask a kinesiologist and a dancer, what's rhythm, the typical scale of that would be fractions of a second. But if you ask somebody coming from psychology and organizational dynamics, this is like a hospital or school working with employees and teachers and students, the rhythm of life in a school or a hospital institution at the company, that's days, weeks, months as they learn how to do stuff, right? And if you look at the city of, rhythm of cities, this was written by Henri Lefebvre, for example, and many people doing urban planning and architecture, geography, the scale of time is seasons, generations, and centuries. Rhythms are different in these different genres, these different regimes. Okay, so the scientific story is, well, philosophical questions, what's rhythm? So we're talking to these, working to people in these different domains in different countries, in Vienna, Goldsmiths, London, in Canada, PhD, and trying to get examples of rhythm. We're also working with artists, coming from movement arts, and trying to understand what's rhythm there. So the science, the new kind of knowledge is understanding what we mean by rhythm, and then make new kinds of instruments that modulate rhythm in a much richer way. So that's one stream, to give an example of that kind of thing. So we have about four of these kinds of streams. And it depends on who's around. So we have new PhDs coming in, we have new undergrads coming in. We design these kinds of experiments under those broad streams of research. So we have definitely have some streams going on. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about how you define those areas, or how you arrive at those research questions in relation to a kind of movement away from ontologies that are more conventional?
Thank you for that. The question is, how do we define where these kinds of streams of research with regard to this like, different way of thinking about what the world is made of? So I think at least some of you in the audience are doing work and research work about, you know, like more conceptual types of projects, right? So what motivated a lot of this work for all these years is about not so much thinking about what's about the world, right? What, you know, talk about experience in the world. But one way to think about that might be asking, well, what the world is made of, you know? You can say, one way to answer that is in terms of physics, right? The atoms, the elements. Or you can answer in terms of the question of classification of bacteria, of animals and plants. Or you can say the world is made of stories, and you can classify the kinds of stories there are, right? Or it's music, so what kinds of music is there, are there? But all along, what we've been trying to do is say, no, this is not just about that question in terms of what are the categories of the world. You know, there's, you know, different kinds of music. So you have these genres of music that the music perception people will give us. That's what you're talking about. Or machine learning, right? With AI, it's all about, you know, categorizing, classifying the world. Instead, we think about not what a thing is, but how a thing comes to be. Like, in other words, question of identity. I'm born in America, my parents came from Nigeria, so they call me Chinese American, but I never felt Chinese American. I grew up Chinese. I was just Chinese happening to live in Washington, D.C., Memphis, Tennessee, Dayton, Ohio, back to Washington, D.C. again, but I never felt Chinese American. It was meaningless to me. But in the boxes, you check Chinese American. So the question of identity is a fundamental problem, as we well know. So the basic question there is, well, how did I become me? With parents who taught me to keep my Chinese name, speaking Chinese at home, you know, not being ashamed of it because my parents were professors. So there was no shame in being Chinese at that point, in that period of time. Okay, in a time when kids were, you know, they could be laughed at for having a funny name, for example. So this question is about identity formation. How do I become who I am? Not so much Chinese American, but how do I become who I am, and how do I raise my child who's mother was Italian. So he grew up half his life in Italy and half in California. And he's not Chinese, not American, not Italian, but he's all three of them, right? So those categories don't work anymore, as we know. Mm. So this is a fundamental question, right? The question would be something like, how do we become what we are? Or how does even, you know, so you can ask even of an object, how does a car become what it is? Or why do we have so many self-driving cars on the streets now? In my town, one was killed 2 weeks ago by this research from, I guess, Uber too. Yeah. Anyway, a self-driving car that ran her over at 40 miles an hour. So why, not how, does a transportation system of the city evolve in such and such a way? Okay. So we're very interested, urgently, in how things become, right? So there's this other edge to it. More questions in the back? Yes, please.
So I'm curious about the insistence on the category of these things happening in real time, and what your understanding of that is, and kind of the rejection, I mean, both the rejection of the recording as part of the experiment, or that it's not recorded, this isn't just a microphone, this is, you know, a transducer, this is all of that. So just the first part is about the insistence on real time and why you think that's significant.
Yeah. Well, let me come to real time, okay? But let's first talk about recording. First of all, it's not about one is better than the other, right? It's more about what has been less explored in the 20th century, 21st century. And this is just a hypothesis, a way to start, is that if we look at, you know, like electronic music or recording sound, that's fairly modern, it's interesting. So this idea that, you know, up until whatever, you know, Brahms recording in that wax cylinder, you know, that was not that long ago, that sound doesn't just go exactly off into infinity, right? I speak and the walls reverberate and it's gone. So this idea that sound could be captured and recorded back is magic, it's a modern miracle, right? Electrical miracle. So it's extremely powerful. This idea that you can actually capture the ephemeral input. So we're still enchanted with this idea. But unfortunately, there's another aspect, which is that we take the recorded item, that is a mark, or we can't take the recorded mark or the stand-in for that which it supposedly represents, right? The problem of representation that any of us in arts, right, are vitally concerned with. So you can say, well, that's not me. Well, it was a picture of you. You were doing that. Did you or did you not shoot that guy, right? And there's all this apparatus of verification that, yes, indeed, that is authentic. Huge apparatus, right, of validation that the representation is accurate. So, but if we look at philosophers from the 20th century, from Derrida onward, and of course before too, but more especially Derrida onward, we learn that this is a very slippery thing. This idea, this conceit, that representation is somehow identical to that which it represents. Okay. We don't have time to go into too much today right now, but this is one critical reason why we want to maybe push back on this emphasis of all the technologies of representation, as if that is the world. Think about another thing, databases. We all now subject to data, right? It's called data mining. Some artists looking at sonification, visualization of data, right? As if data were the world. Again, as artists or as critical theorists or philosophers, we know that data, again, has a very slippery relationship to that which it purports to be representation. So part of what we're doing is to do what I call Aikido. Instead of taking a blow or hitting back directly, let's just step aside. Let's just step away. Not even fight that fight, okay? Because the people are really good at arguing this thing. So instead, we say, here, let's show you a different way of using technology for real-time work, for gestural work, for immediacy. Where's the inspiration for that? So one of them is, I nothing rough and scratchy. Oh, I usually have something rough and scratchy. I don't know. Can you hear this?
Yeah.
But I can't hear this. I'm not enough surface.
Scratch the line.
Yeah, scratch
the line. Right straight on the fabric.
Okay. Is that okay? Well, this might not work. Okay, so I'm going to do something. thing and see if you can hear it. Wow, this probably won't work. Oh, actually. Can you do this?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Who's controlling this? So, see if I can. First, it can be random. Okay, random noise. Or. What did I do? It's a signature. I wrote my name, of course. Signature. So it's intentional. That gesture was intentional. So, and you guys can hear it. Isn't that amazing? You may not know what I wrote, but you know it was intentional. And intentionality is carried in this nuance. So there's so much we can do. So instead of this silliness about user interaction, user does A, computer does A prime, user does B, computer does B prime. We're kind of sat with that from 1960s, let's say. So there's also this kind of very other branch of thinking and working is all the world is responding to us at what I call the speed of physics. So when you just rub your finger over paper or when you dive into a swimming pool, the swimming pool, in this case, doesn't build up a model of your cognitive stats. It doesn't build up a AI model, a neural network model, classifying your intention. It doesn't even care that you are you, really. It's indifferent. The water molecules are indifferent to me. And yet, I can swim. I can do water games. I can write my signature in water, even, right? I can do intentional things, and yet the world, the material world, is indifferent to my intention. So this is a deep question: is how do I quote interact with material world, and how can you think about my intention, our sociality, in terms of material dynamics, right? Without pretending that the universe builds up a cognitive model. Without even requiring that I build up a cognitive model of what I'm doing, what we are doing. This is a profound question, actually, right? So that's the other reason why we think about, quote, real-time media. And then finally, I agree, that real-time means different things according to different modalities, so that shifts according to context. Yeah. Great question, yes?
I'm gonna share one of the students' questions posted earlier today, actually, based on the reading you've assigned. Have you considered or have you collaborated with virtual reality artists to produce a VR project or augmented reality-based project?
Yes, I should say. We've been doing a lot of work with all this work, I say, augmented reality, or people maybe would call it mixed reality. It's just a terminology thing. So like I said, I mean, we're very interested in the augmentation of our environment, the real environment, which is so rich, so that you can make expressions with the augmented environment, okay? Do expressive work. Does not exclude film or video, actually. We just use it to, augment the space, right? But VR, virtual reality, the difference with VR stuff, as many of you have tried it, if you made your own, let's say, Unity-based VR thing on the HMD, is it blocks out the whole rest of the world, right? Mm-hmm. You look at people doing VR, using a goggle, it's just like here and on your ears. So what about the rest of you? Right. So it's very interesting. It's like that the front page, the very cover page of Society of Spectacle by Guy Debord. It shows all these people, right? You must have all read this. Shows all those people sitting in the theater looking at the cinema, and they have 3D glasses on them, and they're all staring straight ahead, and they're completely in their own world, right? Not really in their own world. So this kind of mass parallel, right? So with the VR, so instead of doing VR systems, we went to Sundance, this is like now 4 weeks ago, and we've been talking with what's it called, Emerge? No, it's called New Frontier, right? New the people, who's, well, some of you probably have been. So anyway, there's a standard film festival, and there's also a small thing called New Frontier, which is about new technologies, and VR is very big right now, of course. So we were talking about live event, and how can we actually augment the live event and leverage all the affordances of the real world? So let me give you a very simple example. if you do VR and walking down the VR street and kicking a ball, how, or playing soccer even more, how does the system know to do what to do? Right? Just think about it. If anybody's done this, do you have to do what do you have to do? Collision detection. How does it know that your foot is collided with the ball? You get a physics engine, you get the model for the ball, et cetera, et cetera. Fair amount of coding to do, but you know, it's doable, but it's kind of complicated. How do you do that in the real world? This thing is collided with my hand. I feel it. In fact, the fidelity of this is perfect because it's the real world, right? So all the work we've been doing is working with our engineers to actually build sensors into physical objects and build media that can project it into the physical world. So we gain all the richness and fidelity of atomic physics, right? The response in real time because it's physics. And we layer magic on top. So when one of our faculty can do the following. We can take a ball, bounce it on a ping pong paddle, right? And on the ball it's bouncing, you change its face. And it can make little sounds, and it can beam the sound to the ball so that it can appear to you as if the ball itself are making the sound. That's the stuff that we have to work with. So there's no reason to go to VR anymore if we can augment the physical environment like that, I think. Please. Come and play. I mean, we need more people to come and try this out and actually try to offer something. Please.
Yeah, just something about
the question is about live versus recorded performance and what's the pleasure. And you already answered that. I mean, I think so, right? I mean, we probably all think so. They're just different forms, right? Different genres of art, of sonic art. But this interesting fact, right? I mean, I don't know about this year, but let's say 5 years ago or maybe more, 10 years ago, musicians were discovering that they couldn't make that much money off recordings anymore, or the whole industry, right? Just went down by more than 15 years ago. So a lot of small bands, certainly in Montreal and Quebec, where there's a rich, you know, alternative music scene, went back to just doing gigs, making all their money, basically paying the rent through gigs, right? And so the files were just to put out the work. You can find them that way. So all the pleasure and all the money actually was done with live performance. So that's a big thing, of course. So that points back to this other thing about music is making music. A lot of the work we're trying to do is make it so it's not just us in the room, we're professionals, let's say. It's also anyone on the planet. Why not just make tools so that everybody can actually make gestural sound, that is, to sing, really. I mean, if you look at Georgian culture, Nicaragua, Italy, you know, 19, through all the centuries until recently, I don't know about your homes. I was married to an Italian for 20 years, and it was no big deal. We were at dinner, we were taking a walk, we were in the car, and these were all you know, city people, and at some point people start to sing. I'm a different generation. People start to sing. No big deal. It's just a way of being social together, right? But here, after iTunes, it's playlists. So my son and his generation, he's now 27, they were going through playlists, so they didn't sing. Singing wasn't part of socializing anymore, not in that generation. So he would make music through laptop, right? He would start to code Maximus P. Jitter or do Logic, whatever, or Ableton, and make music that way, but they're not as gestural until recently as what we could do with body. So it might be goes in ways. So maybe this gesturality of interaction allows, perhaps this is a guess, maybe more and more people to once again, right? Collectively, socially engage one another through gestural sound, that is singing, maybe. Mm-hmm. Right. Please.
I've been trying to formulate this question in my head for a little while. We're looking at this milieu of kind of a flat ontology. focused on agency as opposed to objecthood and objects acting on objects, right? We have sensor packages that we carry around with us that record our data, and we use code to create agency in objects. But microcontrollers create, allow a sort of agency that is independent of human intervention. It's based on human intentionality, right? Intentionality in code, but it's separate from a human actually having to do something. The work that you've shown has taken place within laboratory environments, sort of more closed off environments, with the exception of some of the more public installation pieces. And I'm wondering, that's probably because the technology required is still rather vast, right? You need to place sensors in certain places. You need your servers running code, your physics engines. The hardware requirements are probably so vast that they still have to take place within certain controlled environments. And I'm wondering how you see over the next 10 to 20 years that shifting as miniaturization increases, as its processing power increases, as sensor size reduces, to move this art, this human-computer interaction into the public space. And I'm wondering if you could expand also on how those sorts of like electronic sensor dialectics can be used to help us understand and expand our understanding of our experience in reality, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that is a fascinating and very actually sophisticated question. So let me try to give a brief answer and talk more later. So my friends who are filmmakers, you know, they say you look at what's inside the camera and you can see a rich environment, but if you back off and look outside the frame, there's this huge apparatus that comes into view, right? I mean, you know more than me. I mean, all the booms and all the lights and light kits and then the gear and the rigging and the pipes and then da-da-da-da, and you have the camera rolling around. Well, now it's not so big. So the apparatus that's used to make a magic environment is enormous compared to the environment itself. Same with our apparatus, you're right. There's that aspect. The other aspect though, since about 10 years ago, not 15 years now, there's been a lot of work in computer engineering to make ubiquitous devices, right? But very powerful computers that can be the grain of sand, like the Dust Project in Berkeley. And I didn't show you that, but there's a lot of that kind of work. It's hard to photograph because it's by definition, it's not spectacular, right? You put it into a button, or you weave it into a cloth, and it's gone. So it's this idea of pervasive computing. So that's a very important strand in our work over the last few years. Now, some of the students have gone on to look at new kinds of operating systems that are not the kind of operating systems we have in the phone or in the computer. They're different. They're much more fine-grained. So yes, there's underground engineering work to be done. And one of the faculty, Robert Nikama, in my school, we hired him to do, look like 5-20 years down the line to this kind of architecture at hardware and software and operating system level. So there's a lot of work going in that way. So the question would be like, I want to go out down the street, I want to enchant the street by just whatever it is, and whatever happens to be around, well, do the quote right thing. Okay, that's the engineer's job. Why would we want that? And what will happen if that comes to be? That's what we're trying to work on with synthesis and with arts and engineering. So we prototype those kinds of situations and say, what the hell's gonna happen to us? Give an example. We already have it. It's called ATM. Every time you go to an ATM machine, it's actually already a robotic system whose body parts span literally the planet. Its logic depends on legal code, the Bretton Woods treaties, and the Federal Reserve of these different nations, and it has to decide whether to give you cash or not. It just doesn't have to move very much, but it's a vast robot, actually, with some AI behind it. Okay? So there already is infrastructure built into our world that conditions the way we can disenchant or enchant public space. The trouble is that normally we can't get our hands on that logic. We cannot. I mean, I can give you a maximum SP jitter and, you know, in a couple of months or a year, you can write your own magic stuff and then show it somewhere, okay? But who can get their hands? What artists and designers can get their hands on the way the city streetlights are functioning? That's one of our goals, is to do the politics and hiring people who can actually construct logic and at the infrastructure level. So I want to name one person, Linnea Tillett. She's an amazing lighting designer with her own company called Tillett Lighting Design in Brooklyn. And she's been doing this kind of work for many years. Actually. Infrastructure art, infrastructure design. So. Please.
I'll actually add another question. You mentioned a few times the idea of magic in what you're doing, and the work, some of the work you show during the presentation, it kind of makes sense in like some of the outdoor presentations that you show pictures of. It's almost, there's a certain dreamlike quality to some of them. Like for example, the room with the piano and the chairs and all these hundreds of black strings. It's a sort of image you would normally think of. Oh, I had this weird dream. All these pianos in this room, all these, they were surrounded by all this weird webbing and strings. What does this mean? And later you show the like the cloud, the attempt to create a cloud. Because in the real world, we normally don't touch clouds. The clouds as ethereal, it's like they're so far away from us. And yet in our dreams, we think, oh, I could touch the clouds. We have like the dream, you know, you've seen the cartoon where the character dreams about touching the cloud, you're walking in a cloud. And you're literally creating that notion that I can actually touch the cloud. I can actually touch this this ethereal thing that I couldn't touch before. I mean, I think that's what some of what your work is really about. It's sort of like crossing magic. If you call it magic, you also call it like sort of like creating a dreamlike state in the real world. Could that be?
Yeah. I mean, I say it here verbally, but I don't want to be recorded saying that. sorry, it's been recorded. Sorry, too late. Why? Because, okay, yes, right off. And this is a personal aesthetic. It's not a research thing, okay? It's just the way I think about making art of a certain kind, right? So it's not like, oh, everybody works with me, has to do it that way. That's a personal thing. So yes, that's an aesthetic choice. But when I write carefully, I don't use magic and dream because, even though I say that, because those words are very powerful. I have a great respect for that. And, you know, it's too easy to say that. And, you know, because now at MIT, there's people who do, I should say that, what's it called? Enchanted objects. Basically, it's product design. That's all it is. It's product design. Okay. And they may be good at it, but it's not enchantment. I mean, come on. So I want to be very judicious when I say enchantment, or not magic, but enchantment, or alchemy, or dreaming. So for dreams, I refer people to the Dream and Nightmare Laboratory in UDM, because UDM resident in Montreal, with Tori Nielsen. He's a psychologist who studies dreams, and he's one of the top dream researchers in the world. He's another lab at Harvard University, and we have a common student, former student, Lisa Solomonova, who's doing work on the sense of having a body in dream state, as just another mode of embodied experience. It's not wrong or the underbelly of consciousness. It is a mode of consciousness. And so that's her. She uses neuropsychiatric techniques, and she uses meditation techniques, and she uses embodied and inactive philosophy, combining that. She's not McGill. So with respect to alchemy versus magic, this is just a way I use those two words, okay? When you say magician, you think of tricks. You are pulling the wool over somebody's eyes, so the actual thing is just merely mechanical, but you just do sleight of hand or divert attention. So that's amazing, actually, amazing work. Or it's anthropological, meaning it's a ragmas, right? It's a group of people in society who are called magicians, so they're distinctive in such and such a way. That's just a category. I'm being unfair, okay, to the anthropologist. By alchemy means something else. Remember I talked about Isaac Newton? He was the last alchemist, but he was also the first physicist. So an alchemist has a this is the way I use the word alchemy, okay? Alchemist, whereas a magician or sorcerer, at least in games or whatever, the idea is power. I'm a sorcerer, I'm a wizard, I'm a magician, I have power to command the world to do such and such a thing. Okay? This idea is power. So, and you know what it's got. This is the rant part. You know what it's got from us, right? So let's put that kind of attitude aside, both in games and in real life, to not have this kind of sorcerous attitude toward the world. This is about things, capitalism and sorcery. Okay? This is about things I highly recommend. Instead, is there an alternative way to think about the following? to think about stuff like water. I don't have hot cups. Okay, here's a glass of water. This is my last prompt. Okay, here's a glass of water. I could drink it, or I could throw it in down the drain, or I could throw it on the floor indifferently. You know, like who's gonna say that's the wrong thing to do to, right, at that moment? The water's not gonna say that, maybe you are. But I can't do that to you. I cannot just throw you away or dispose of you or use you as I wish, because it would be unethical to treat you that way. So, question. The people in Newton's day, Isaac Newton's day, said, we agree with you on the laws of gravity. What we don't agree with you is your contention, Newton's contention, that matter is brute and inert. The matter is dumb. It doesn't have sentience. It's brute and inert. Those were the famous phrase. The beginning of science was the separation between the affairs of spirit, you know, the occult, the mystical, we call that now, those things, and of matter. Okay. And logic and rationality was applied only to matter. So it's a problem, though, these days to use this distinction, because we say magic or sorcery, we think of, you know, wizards or warlocks and silly things like that. But back before Newton, they refused in natural philosophy. What those people thought was that matter is suffused with value. Just as you, each of us, is suffused with value. You have a value as a living being, so I can't just throw you away. I shouldn't just use you as I would use a screwdriver. Okay, that would be unethical. Because there's always an ethical relationship between me and each one of the other living beings on this planet. The question that we're doing in our synthesis center is, what about matter itself? What about water? What if we take that very seriously, those people who were both philosophers and physicists back in, you know, Newton's time, and say, okay, let's take this on, that matter, all matter, is suffused with value. Then it follows that I and we have ethical relationships with matter itself. We cannot just indifferently throw water down the drain. So this is also underwriting a lot of work with the Synthesis Center, is how to think and design ecosystemically with the stuff. So when we say alchemy, we mean to have that alchemical attitude toward it. Long answer.
The one person.